Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.
For Sunday school, then you got, in fact, I brought all the Sunday school classes in this morning, and we dealt with some things. I want you to open your Bibles to Proverbs chapter 18. Proverbs chapter 18. We'll look there to begin with. I'm going to really kind of continue what we laid out this morning. I preach a message on what to do when people do you wrong. I'm not preaching that this morning. But I started Sunday school off, and I'll start this service off the same way. How many of you, somebody's ever done you wrong? Raise your hand, all right? They've done you wrong. Okay, that's everybody. I think everybody's hand was up, unless you're living in a shell somewhere and in some cave by yourself, then at one time or another, somebody has done you wrong. And that wrong could have been something they said to you. That wrong could have been something they did to you. That wrong could be something you thought they should have done that they did not do. That wrong, when you begin to look at that, you're like, and you dwell on what those people did. That's when I preach that message on what to do when people do you wrong. I preach the first half on what not to do. Don't relive it. Don't sit around thinking. If you sit around thinking about what they said, how they said it, then you're going to be thinking about what they meant and whether I bet they would have said this. You're going to add more to it in your own mind. Don't relive it. Here's the second thing. Don't revile them. Jesus, when he was reviled, he reviled not again. So what good is it going to do if you revile someone when they revile you? Well, I want to. Well, I'll get into that. Of course you want to. That's your old flesh. My flesh and yours wants to get them back. Well, that's the last thing, though. Don't get revenge either. Amen. Don't get revenge. Amen. Tell you what I'm going to do. And so we're working it out, man. We can't wait till the next time we see them so we can make them feel like we felt when they said or did whatever they did to us. Right. I said preaching that. And by the way, that's what you don't do. You say, well, what do when people do you wrong? Forgive them. I can't forgive them. Well, yeah, you can. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians, the Bible says, be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted. Now, that's both of those two things right there. I mean, being kind to somebody. Well, I can be kind to them if they're kind to me. Show me that in the Bible. Yeah. Right. Well, I'll be tender-hearted, but if they're tender-hearted, no. God didn't say be tender-hearted if they're tender-hearted. They might be the most hard-hearted and hard-headed person in the world. But see, what happens is when we're done wrong, if we're not careful, I don't know what made that person do you wrong. But if we think about it, if we don't deal with it the way God said to deal with it, then you are going to become what that person that did you wrong is. Why'd they do you wrong? I don't know. Sounds like they're bitter to me. Sounds like they're not. Here you go. They're not walking with God to me. If they did you that wrong, it sounds like maybe they're either not saved or they're really backslid. Sounds like if they did you wrong, then they're very hard-hearted. Sounds like if they did you wrong, then that's the way that person is. But you see, if you're not careful when they did that to you, hey, is that making you hard-hearted? Is that making you, or did that make you, you know? In other words, I'm not preaching on that. I want to stay on my track this morning. I'm just telling you, you don't revile them, and then you don't get revenge. But you forgive them. Here's the next thing. You favor them. The Bible says do good to them. In fact, in Matthew, I had it open there. The Bible says this is what the Son. By the way, here's your Savior now. Ye hath heard it had been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to rise on the just, on the evil, on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. Here, this really reveals it. For if you love them which love you, what reward have ye? Preacher, but that's easy. I didn't say it. Yeah, that's right. That's easy. If somebody loves you, you love them. They talk good to you. You talk good to them. Oh, preacher, I can love that person so good. I get the warm fuzzies when I talk to them. Good. I'm glad you get warm fuzzies. Amen. But the Bible says, for if you love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans the same. He's saying a lost world does that. Lost world, somebody treats them pretty good, they're probably going to treat them pretty good. They do them right, they'll probably do them right. But then the Bible says, if you salute your brethren only. Now see, saluting now, it's one thing to do good to somebody. Saluting is just talking and being kind and being nice. If you salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans do so? He said, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. Now, what he's trying to help you with right there, and I want you to think about this. This, hey, when you begin to think about this matter of getting right with somebody or somebody getting right with you. See, the Lord, he tells us what not to do, and then he tells us what to do. He kind of reveals, he shows us our heart even when we don't like to see it. I'm going to be preaching this morning on help for the hurting. Because a lot of people I know, they've been hurt. They've been done wrong. Sometimes, again, it's by what you say. I said in the Sunday school hour, if you were here, that what I dealt with is it gets back to God. We took it back to God. You know, why does God allow bad things to happen to good people? Why does God allow bad things to happen to, good people? We establish first that the Bible says there's none good, no, not one. So we can't tout too much about our goodness when God says we're sinners, you know. And so then the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So we're sinners. Now, by the way, this morning's service is going to be a little bit different. You can already tell that. By now, I'm usually foaming and running and just laying it out a different way. But I want to show you something here that's going to help you. In fact, this is one of those messages where there's messages that can educate you. There's messages where you may leave out of there saying, man, I know more than I know now. And I hope you do that with this one. There's sometimes you'll leave out of there and say, man, the Spirit of God was there. And I hope you leave out of here and say, man, the Spirit of God was there this morning. But there's some messages when you leave out of there and you say, my life will forever be different because I acted on what I heard preached. And that's the difference. The Bible says not to be it says to be doers of the word and not hearers only. And I don't care how old you are. See, we oftentimes, if we're not careful, we go to blaming God when bad things happen. We say, well, no, I haven't done that yet. No, that's the progression of it. That's where it ends up. At first, we blame the person. Wicked person, terrible person. Boy, I tell you, they're absolutely wicked. And then, I don't know every altercation that happens with people, but there's an old worldly slogan that says there takes two to tango. They say there's three sides to everything, your side, my side, and what really happened. I read the scripture. By the way, go to Proverbs chapter 18 with me, if you will. The text verse is this in verse 14. The spirit of a man will sustain his iniquity, but a wounded spirit, who can bear? I'm talking about somebody that's been hurt. Somebody that could be your feelings hurt, could be your pride was hurt. I've seen people physically hurt. They say 1 in 4 girls is abused when they're little. 1 in 6 boys. God help. People are murdered. People are raped. People, when they're young, make foolish decisions. There's abortion. Again, we make foolish decisions about how we lived at one time in our life. We can't go back and change that. I wish we could. Man, I wish we could change everything you go back and you're like, well, Lord, I wish I'd never done that. I wish we could do that, but you can't change that, but I'm glad God can forgive it. I'm glad God can wash it, and I'm glad God can make you clean this morning, amen. And I'm glad God has no record of it once he's done that, hallelujah. I'm glad God wipes the slate completely clean. But see, what happens is, and I said this in Sunday school too, but just to catch you up, that you have on all of us, we have that side of us where it's the meet and greet side. Hey, how you doing? I can do that with a teller at the bank. I can do that with somebody out that I don't even know. You can too. In other words, it's the side of you where you allow people to, in other words, it's the friendly side of you. Then you have a little bit closer to you where you have some real close friends and people that are your confidants, if you will, people that you're close to. Then you got your loved ones. I mean, they're even closer to you. You really love them and you're close to them and you may even open up to them a lot more. But everybody has that place in your own heart and in your own life where you put things like this, things that happen that nobody knows about, things that were done that nobody knows about, things that were done to you that nobody knows about, things you did to others nobody knows about. And what you do is you put those, that's that place you don't even go. Sometimes it was so bad you just try to forget about it. I don't want to dwell on it, don't want to think about it, don't want to talk about it. You don't bring it up. I mentioned in Sunday school about talking to a guy talking to a lady, and she's talking about her, her mom, you know, and says, well, she says, where's your mom? I don't know. And we split up a long time ago, and just some situation, and oh man, it's just been terrible. It's terrible, terrible. And where she lived? Don't know. Well, you don't know? No. Don't you care? No. Oh, is she alive? I don't care. You don't care if your mother's alive. you don't if she's breathing. Where's she at? What's going on? I see they put that so far back. They just saying, hey, it was a hurt, whatever happened that hurt them. And here, they never dealt with it. But when you begin talking to them and they start snapping off like that, no, I don't know. I don't care. When it's showing that they're still bitter in their heart about it. See, how you feel about somebody shows your heart. I can't help what they did. They may have been so wrong, it was wrong as wrong can be. But you understand, you control how you react to whatever it is they did. And I'm trying to show you, I want to show you something in the Bible right here. It's talking about a wounded spirit. Who can bear? That's a bad thing, a wounded spirit. The wounded spirit is rough, brother. And I said this morning in the Sunday school about being mindful of, if we're not careful, that about reviling, be careful. The Lord is trying to work in your life, even with this thing that's going on, what God's trying to do. There's a lot of things He'd love to help you with, but if we're not careful, we begin to revile. Hey, when somebody does you wrong, how many people do you tell? Don't get all quiet at the same time. Because we find ourselves telling a lot of people. Well, I know you say it, when it's been done for a long time, we tell a lot of people. Right. If there's something you don't like, you tell a lot of people. If there's something they said or did to you, and you lay it out, it's just unbelievable. Now, here's what the Bible says. Look at verse 17. He that is first in his own cause seemeth just. It didn't say that he was just. He seemeth just. You know what that means? Everybody thinks they're right. Everybody thinks they're right. Let me tell you something. Even if they're wrong, they think they're right. I mean, because think about it. Whoever did whatever they did, I mean, normally you got the offender and the offended. The Bible says, I know what the Bible says in Psalm 119:65. It says, great peace have they that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. I know that's what the Bible says. So that tells me it can be done. And God's trying to get us to a place in our Christian growth to where even when people do us wrong, that we're at a place where we instead of getting offended, you know, we deal with it a lot different. In fact, we deal with it like the Bible says. I said about what to do when people do you wrong. You forgive them. You favor them. And the Bible says do good to them that persecute you. Find something good you can do for that person that is persecuting you. The Bible says, love your enemies. Now, love, we're like, preacher, that's the wrong kind of love. Let me ask you something. Do you love your wife? What do you do for her? Do you love your husband? What do you do for him? Do you love your kids? What do you do for them? All right, look, love your enemies. Amen. Preacher, nobody's saying amen. I didn't expect it. That's different, preacher. Now, here's what's going to happen. what happens is in because people tell me they take Bible, they say, well, preacher, I don't care. It's like, I don't care what the Bible says. This is the real world. And in the real world, somebody does me wrong, I'm doing them wrong. And I mean, they do it to me, I'm doing it back twice. Now, there ain't nothing in the Bible about that. You're right. You got to move the Bible out of the side if you're going to deal with it like that. Absolutely. You know. I'll tell you what, boy, I'm going to go over there and open up a can of whoop head on them. Okay? Show me that in the Bible. That ain't in the Bible. Oh, okay. Let's just clarify that. That's how Christians, show me where that's how Christians act. Well, that ain't in the Bible. Okay. If it's not in the Bible, then what's the deal, man? So if that's not of the spirit, that's of the flesh. If that's not of God, then that's of the, so the devil. Preacher, you're too black and white with that Bible. Black and white. Look up here, black and white. Preacher, I have a right to be angry. I didn't say you're not going to get angry about it. Preacher, I'm hurt. I know you're hurt. What I'm trying to deal with you about is how you're about to react with it. Everybody's been hurt. And let me help you with something. If you have been hurt, guess what? You will get hurt again. Some people say this, I got hurt at church. I'm not going back to church. I'm glad you didn't get hurt in the bathroom. Amen. Amen. Listen to me. I said what is God doing? I said, why does God allow bad things to happen? I dealt with three things. He lets that happen so that sinners will get saved. He lets that happen so that saints will get right. And then he lets that happen because God's wanting his servants to surrender. Gave accounts where people got where people died, but people got saved through it. I've seen people get cancer and somebody get right with God because of it. I've seen, and you have too. I'll not go down through the list of just things that we have. See, but God, hey, realize this. Preacher, why did God allow this to happen to me? Maybe God's trying to grow you. How are you going to grow? Adversity. How does God, the Bible says tribulation worketh patience. It's not just patience. There's a lot of things that patience goes along with. Preacher, wait a minute. Somebody ran their mouth. And by the way, when somebody runs their mouth, usually they lose their temper. And that's why they do that. All right, so think about it. For whatever reason, that person is that angry. Hey, let me ask you, why are they angry? Now, the Bible talks about there are those in the Bible that are angry without cause. That can happen. There's some that can be slap angry, and you never till you meet Jesus will you know why they were angry. But when people get angry, go ahead. What are they going to do? They're going to say something they should not say. They're going to treat people the way they should not be treated. They're going to act a way they would not normally act. So in their anger, the Bible talks about folly and foolishness going along with anger. So if you're, look, when you lose your, and I'm talking, let's say when we lose our temper, that's what we do. I'm not like that. Okay, you didn't do that, but you did something, you do something foolish when you get angry. Come on. Well, I didn't act like that person. You're trying to compare yourself with them. And you're always going to make yourself look better because you probably, you know, maybe you are. You know, maybe you do better than they do in some situation. All right, I got you. But that doesn't still make it right for you to do wrong in how you deal with it. Let me ask you, Where in the Bible do you have a right to get bitter? Where in the Bible do you have a right to stay angry if you get angry? Can you show me that? Now, you're the Christian, so I'm dealing with Christian attributes. See, the Bible says here, the Bible says, he that is first in his own cause seemeth just. The Bible says in verse 19, a brother offended, it's harder to be won than a strong city. Their contentions are like bars of iron. Let me ask you something. When somebody has done you wrong and later they repent about it and they come to you and ask you to forgive you, how many times have we been, here, we're still mad. And you know what? Here's what we think. They don't mean it. I mean, first thing is, they don't mean it. That's our defense. It's a defense mechanism. Well, they're not sincere. I mean, because they're not crawling on glass and bleeding and you know, I just don't think they could really mean that. See, that's in your own mind. It's nowhere else. I don't know. Look, I know this. What would it take for you to go to somebody and ask them to forgive you? Now, and I guess they could say about you, you're not sincere. Get out of here, unsincere one. You could. But you understand, here, you're doing the same. So you wouldn't want that done if you did it, but we do that, don't we? First thing is, they're not sincere. They don't mean it. Next thing is, I'm not going to accept it. I want you to forgive me. Whatever. You're not forgiving them. Here, sometimes we even say it and we don't mean it. I forgive you. We don't mean it. We're faking it. We're lying. Here's what we're doing. We're harboring that resentment in our heart. And what started off with a germination is now aggravation inside of you, really. See, it's coming up. And here's the thing. Now, the root is your bitterness. The root is, but here's the deal. The fruit is what's gonna, what is what everybody's gonna see. Here, let me guess. You do two things. You don't talk to them, but you do talk to others about what they did. I'm not going to talk to them after what they said to me because you're still offended. Hadn't forgiven them, hadn't got it right in your own heart. Say, preacher, it's hard for me to do. Oh, yeah, yeah, that's why I'm preaching on this morning. If it was easy, y'all, hey, if it was easy, then guess what? Number one, if nobody ever had problems with each other, if there was no husband that ever had a problem with a wife, then I don't need to teach on this. If there was never a parent and a child that if they agreed all the time and there was never a disagreement, then I'd never have to deal with this. If there were never church members that don't do wrong to church members, then I'd never need to deal with this. If there was never people on the job that did something wrong to somebody else on the job, then I'd never need to deal with this. But guess what? There is, isn't there? And it does happen. And when it does, what you got to see, the Lord again, the Lord's trying to use this, and you say, wait a minute, why? You mean, you're telling me that God may have allowed this because he's wanting to see how I'm going to respond to it? Again, that's called Christian growth. A temptation comes your way. Do you fall to it? Do you yield to it? Or do you resist it? A temptation to sin comes your way. I don't know what the Bible says, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. All right? What do you do with that sin? Does it conquer you every time? Or do you, through the Scripture and through the grace of God, get to a place to be able to say, no, that's not what God wants. That's not honoring God. I'm not going to do that. Now, guess what? Temptation is going to keep coming until God helps you overcome it. I can't believe that. Now, again, I can't go back over everything that I dealt with in Sunday school because we don't have time here. Because in Sunday school, we went over the fact that, number one, God didn't cause sin. Man did. God's not the author of sin. Man is. And God, hey, God, is this matter of bad things happening? Hey, these are things that are put in motion because of we're born into a sinful world, and because man has a free will. Whoever they are, they can choose to do the most wicked things imaginable, say the most terrible things imaginable. And that's lost men or saved men. That's lost women or saved women. Being saved doesn't mean your flesh got saved. And see, what happened is, you got people that are sitting around with a lot of hurt. And that's what I want to remind you of this morning. Write this down. Are you ready? Write this down. Write down the source of hurt. And it's just sin. Sin is the source of hurt. Write that down. Sin is the source of hurt. Sin is. We're born into a sinful world. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's why sinful man needs to be born again. If you're lost, you need to get saved. You're born a sinner, you'll die a sinner, and judgment of God is on sin. Oh, brother, I don't want to die. The penalty for sin is death. The punishment for sin is hell. Nobody ought to die and go to hell. Somebody say amen. Amen. Not after the Son of God took your sin for you. There's only one source of hurt, and that is sin. Now, sometimes, and I'll be honest, much of the hurt I've gotten in my own life was self-inflicted. Now, we're not talking right now about something somebody else did to you. I'm talking about things I've done where I'm reaping what I sowed. Say amen. Amen. Come on now. Hey, that's all of us. Preacher, pastor, I've never sinned. Liar, liar, pants on fire. I'll preach online tonight. You come on back, amen. It'll be good. No. We have sin. Hey, it's self-inflicted. We caused it. We're reaping that. I say this. You say, you say, well, man, that guy, boy, he did this. And Lord, look at all that going on in his life. What's the only thing that could keep from having a full harvest of reaping? Repentance. You repent. Oh, God, I'm so sorry for what I did. God, have mercy on me. Lord, I realize, God, that I did this, and there's consequences to what I do. I understand that. But I tell you, when you do that, you go to pleading the mercy of God. Lord, would you just be merciful? Remember David when he sinned? David, he said, Lord, Lord said, I can do this or do that to you. And he said, Lord, I'll put myself in your hands. Because I can trust you. He had a little baby that died. Oh, man, his son rebelled against him. I mean, split the kingdom. He lost the kingdom. His son's rebellion was one thing, and then the kingdom torn out of his hand. He had to flee from his own kingdom. Oh, a lot of things David had to do, but I want to tell you this, it could have been a lot worse had he not repented. So I say this, you say, preacher, I got some sin in my life. I'd say this, repent then. Do not reap the whole harvest of that sin, man. Repent today. And I'm just telling you, God is merciful. Thank God. But God is just. And this matter of reaping what you sow is a biblical principle in the Bible. Many of our hurt came from, I'm just saying, self-inflicted. Some hurt that you have is not, it's someone else's sin. A little kid is abused. That kid didn't do anything. That's somebody else's wicked sin. Somebody is murdered. Somebody is raped. Some sin against you. Somebody loses their temper with you. That's their sin. Here, you didn't cause that. Do anything you know that you could have done. Now, you understand, sometimes our self-inflicted sin can bring on the anger of somebody else. Our self-inflicted sin can bring on the disdain or the hate or the whatever of somebody else. And so they will say, because you did that, then I did that. Well, see, now they're the ones that's reacting wrong to whatever you did. But sometimes, hey, there's we would look at it and say, well, wait a minute, I feel like I'm totally innocent in this. I didn't cause this. I didn't want this. It happened. That person, if somebody walks into some store and starts shooting people up. These people are just in there shopping. There's just people in there with their family. Some nut gets up, and I mean, some craziness going on. That's you say, preacher, how do you, there's no justification for that. I'm just reminding you, sin is the source of all hurt. And that goes back to this, the fallen state of this world. You can categorize, any sin you want to say, anything anybody can ever do to anybody else, it falls under the matter of we live in under a fallen nature in a fallen world. You say, preacher, I don't like that. I don't like it either, but that's the world we live in. It's a sinful world. How many of y'all know that? Amen. All right. But when you're dealing with this, now here, so the source of all hurt, again, is sin. Came in the garden. I said in Sunday school, wouldn't it be good? We all get to heaven. God lets us line up in a big line and punch Adam in the nose. Boom! Man, I tell you what, you surely messed us up, Adam, when you sinned in the garden. But I say this, let me give you this. What about the side effects of sin? Number one is shame. Shame. Even when somebody does something to you, see, there's things that nobody would ever stand up and say, oh, this happened to me when I was young. This happened or that happened. And even the matter of somebody comes and they join our church and something happened at three churches back and they've never have dealt with it. It's just in their heart. And so every church they go to, they go with the fences up and they really don't really get in because, well, back at that one church, I got hurt. Right. And when I got hurt over there, I've never gone to another church and really got involved. Who's that hurting? Who is that hurting? Hurting you and hurting God. Well, I tell you, when that happened, I just from there on out, hey, we had a friend betray us, and I tell you, we've just not really let anybody get close to us since then. Man, you're missing out on good friendships because of that one bad one. I hate that. Well, I had a church member do me wrong. Well, again, get in line. I'm not minimizing what they did. I'm saying this, you're a church member, and you've done people wrong. Look, I have been offended, and I probably will be offended again. Guess what? I have been the offender, and I probably will be the offender again. Well, I don't think that I will. Everybody's not going to be walking in the Spirit 24/7. And your flesh is going to get away from you, and you're going to say or do something that's, hey, totally abnormal from the way you would normally act or how you would normally talk. And when it does, I'm just telling you, that's when the offenses come. The Bible, understand, shame, being a victim. Let me just say this. Let me help you with something. Being a victim does not reduce your value. Somebody say amen. Amen. Preacher, I was a victim of something and I feel worthless. No, you feel shame. Here's another. Being a victim does not remove your virtue. Say amen right there. I've seen people with terrible things that happened in their past that nobody will ever know about, but I've seen God forgive them, forgive, wash. I've seen God take the bitterness out of that person's heart. I've seen God just give that person an excellent spirit. And you know what? And in the sight of God, you talk about virtuous. You talk about right in the sight of God. They were that way because they got it right with God. Man, I'm glad we don't have to live in our past. Somebody say amen. I'm glad our past doesn't have to dictate our future. Say amen right there. I'm telling you what, brother, just because you used to be something doesn't mean you're going to be that forever. Amen. And by the way, that man or woman that offended you does not mean they're going to be that way forever. And you being right with it and right with God with it might be the one that helps them to see that. Because when you treat them the way that God says treat them, you might be the one that God uses to convict their heart, turn their heart, and change them forever because God helped you to have the grace to deal with it the way that He would have dealt with it. Preacher, you think God can help me to be that kind of Christian? I think that's the kind of Christian God wants you to be. This shame that happens, and by the way, then there's side effects of hurt. It's not just shame. How about blame? How about blame? In other words, either one, I mean, here, we blame that person. And when we've lived that bitter that long, and here it's messed up other relationships we have, it messes up other friendships that we have, We always point back to that one person. Well, I tell you so-and-so, boy, they did this, and that's the reason I have a bitter spirit. That's the reason I'm so angry with everybody around me. That's the reason I treat people the way I do, because that person treated me that way. Boy, I tell you, when that person did me wrong, I mean, from there on out, I've never trusted anybody. I've never got close to anybody. I don't go to church anymore. I don't get close to, and by the way, I don't get close to God anymore. If God would have let somebody like that do something like that to me. See, now you're getting back on God again. We blame the individual. We blame what we call the innocent. We blame God. God's innocent. Did God make that person do that? No. God's told, hey, if you want the innocent person, God's the innocent one. The Lord never did a thing but love us and love us unconditionally. Are you kidding me? Don't blame God with it. I just got this beef with God. Come on. I may get a beef with somebody, but I don't want a beef with the ones that made beef. I mean, He's the creator, amen? I'm like, I'm not going there. But hey, blame, that's the easiest thing we can do. Isn't it so easy to put it on somebody else? They deserve for it to be put on them. No, the only person that never deserved for anything to be put on them was Jesus. And the sin, my sin and yours, the sin of this whole world was laid on the Son of God. He didn't deserve that. But He loved us enough to take it. He took our blame. He died the just for the unjust. I'll never be worthy of that. I'll never feel worthy of that. But if we're not careful, we live in our shame. We live with blame. Here's another. We live with what I call disdain. In other words, you let anger begin to rule your life. That person was angry whenever they did whatever they did to you, but now you're angry. What are you going to do with your anger? I'll find somebody else to take it out on. I'll take it out on them. Vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. You don't take your vengeance out on somebody else. Let God deal with it. Let God get them and do whatever He's going to do with them. I hope they'll get saved or get right. I don't want that. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Whatever they did, you don't want them to get saved or get right? Then what do you want for them? Punishment, preacher. Punishment! That's what I got. That's what they deserve. You're in a rough place. You're in a deep, dark place, man. Whatever got you there, I have no idea, but you keeping yourself there, that's a sin. That's the sin. Here's you another disdain. How about this? And then bad claims. I got to rhyme, you know. That's that distrust for everybody. Everybody's out to get me. But I see people when it's like that here, they face a lot of things. Hey, let me guess, you got a lot of anxiety. You got to take medicine for your anxiety? Because you're so ate up. I'm not talking about, look, hey, medicate what you need. There's things that need to be medicated. I understand that. Some things, you're being medicated for something you hadn't forgiven. And hadn't got it. See, because if that was gone, no anxiety. If that was gone, no depression. If we dealt with it the way God said, it's amazing what God can take away if we deal with it the way God said. Don't leave out of here. Preacher said, don't take my medicine. I did not say that. People sometimes say, well, yeah, the preacher said. I'm like, I didn't say that. I'm like, get the tape, you know. Not tape. I'm sorry, they don't do that anymore. whatever they do up there, amen. I'm like, get it. But hey, let me help you with something. Bad claims. I mean, that's a bad thing about it. Here's you another. And here's the rough part of it. You know, there's some people when they've been done wrong, you know, they're shame, blame, disdain, bad claims. But then some people do the same. Some people were abused when they were a child. And you know what they do now? They abuse children. There's people that were hurt when they were young, and you know what they do now? They hurt people. a sharp tongue cut them, and now their sharp tongue cuts others. A bitter spirit is what that person had that attacked them, and now they have the bitter spirit. They have become what they hated. They become the very thing they hate. You see, you know, I mean, you ever see, I've met ladies. They're like, preacher, I married this guy. He like beats me and does this and all this and all this. And, you know, he finally left. But, you know, I've got this other fellow here now. He's the same way. You know, he's a drug addict. I'm trying to get him off his drugs. You pray for him. And, you know, and the other three wives he beat, he's not going to beat me that way. Now, wait a minute now. I'm not in any way mocking what he did. What I'm saying is they go back to the same thing. Why? Amen. They go back to the same abuse, back and back and back and back. Right. What's the deal? You see, that's the side effects of this, of the being hurt, man. You become the source of the abuse now. Son. And that's not just talking about some little kid that got abused. I'm talking about us. Somebody hurt us, so we hurt them. Somebody talked about us, so we're going to talk about them. Somebody ran us down, we're going to run them down. Somebody snubbed us, we're going to snub them. My goodness. But here, there's got to be a solution for all this. Got to be some help for all this, amen. Everybody go to Ephesians again. Let's go to Ephesians again. Ephesians chapter 5. You ought to read Ephesians 4 and 5, any of it. I mean, I'm sorry, Ephesians chapter 4. It's all good, brother. I'm telling you, it'll help you. All the book of Ephesians, I mean, if you just begin to read that and say, God, speak to my heart about what I need to do in my own Christian life, it'll change your life if you'd read the book of Ephesians. Begin circling verses, underlining verses, and just do what God says in these verses. The Bible says, let's just begin reading in verse 26. Be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Here. Never go to bed without getting it right with God. Let me say that again. Never go to bed without getting it right with God. No, preacher, I'm going to sleep on this. You're going to be more bitter tomorrow than you are right now. You're going to sleep on it? I'm not dealing with this. I'm not getting this right. Now look, the Bible says, as much as possible, live peaceably with all men. You know there's times even when if somebody has done you wrong they've done you wrong or you've done them wrong, and you seek to go get it right, there will be times when they will not let you get it right. We've already established that, right? There's some people that will say, we don't want to talk about it. I'm still too hurt. It's too fresh. Now, the bad thing is I've talked to people and I said, oh, when did it happen? 20 years ago. But it's still so fresh. See, they're that crowd that's reliving it. They're that crowd that hadn't, hey, no forgiveness, no nothing. But here, there's times where you go to people and they will not accept it. You know what you do? You can tell them if you did something to them, I am sorry. And you may never believe that or accept that, but I mean that with all my heart. I'm sorry. And they may accept it or not. They may do something with it or not. Now, you can't help what other people do with you, with your repentance. You can't help that. Let me tell you this. I knew a man that somebody else did him wrong, and he went to that person and he said this. It didn't even sound right, but this is what he said. He said, I want to ask you to forgive me. And you say, well, Wait. That guy did him wrong. He wasn't talking about that situation. I want to ask you to forgive me because I got a terrible, bitter spirit in my heart after what happened. And from that time, I've dealt with you wrong. That takes grace.
Amen.
It takes grace to go to somebody that did you wrong, but because you've dealt with it wrong since then, that you're trying to get it right.
Amen.
Now that person may or may not, they may be so far gone that they may be like, "You're nuts, man." What, just be like, but you know what? You did right. You did right on your side as much as you could.
Hallelujah.
As much as possible, live peaceably with all men. You'd have a good day. I tell you this, wouldn't it be good to have a good conscience before God this morning?
Yes, amen.
Now, you may not be able to have it. You can't make somebody have a good conscience with you. You can't make somebody have the same attitude you have. I wish you could. It doesn't work that way. See, the first thing we do is we get things right with God. We get things right with God. See, because this matter, I'm just telling you, this matter, you say, "Preacher, I really want some help with this," then good. There's got to be confrontation. You got to, confront, admit that it happened. And by the way, like I said in Sunday school, I am not saying stand up in front of, hey, I'm not talking about going to everybody. If I said that somebody said or they heard a preacher say, well, I tell you, what you need to do is everything you've ever done wrong, you need to go tell everybody what you did. And I said, that is a hog stinking wash. Are you nuts? I believe in being just so truthful that you just tell everybody everything you feel and everything you've ever done. I tell you what, fella. Foolishly, in your sin and in your lust, the next time some beautiful woman walks by, you just look over at your wife and say, "Oh, honey, that's one of the best looking women I've ever seen in my life." Because I believe in being truthful with my wife. You're an idiot. Somebody says, now I know that's funny. Here, somebody says, "Preacher, years ago, I committed some sin. We've been married 40 years. I believe I need to bring this to my entire family. I believe I need to tell my entire family." And by the way, if you're going to tell them that sin, tell them every sin. Every sin. Everywhere. Every sin. I don't read here. Show me that in the Bible. My Bible does say this. If we confess our sins, and in that context, he's talking about talking to God. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I did know. I knew a family that a wife decided to do that. A wife decided to get everyone, like a family reunion, man, and make some broad announcement. And you know, she said, "I just thought if I did that, I would feel so much better." And my question, you know, that in my mind, I thought, and so parents, grandparents, grandchildren, nieces, nephews, spouse, children, how did it make them feel?
Yeah.
It split that family. I mean, that just, it blew that family up. They're not together now.
Amen.
But hey, she got it off her chest. I mean, that's what it's all about, right? Making us feel better. Let me tell you the best way to get something off your chest. You take it to God. Take it to God. You want something off your conscience? Take it to God. Take it to the Lord. You know, what's that old song? Take it to the Lord in prayer. Amen? You know, I believe with all my heart God can forgive us. I believe God can help you get things right. But see, here's what you got to look at. Is there anything in... Let me ask you, who could come in this service right now and sit right down next to you and it would ruin your service? Are you thinking about them? Now, if you got somebody like that right now, that's who you need to get right with. Well, I got to go to them. No. First, deal with God. Go to God. Because if you got enough in your heart to where still, whether it was this morning or 20 years ago, it still affects you that way, then there's something to get right, isn't there? If there's a hesitation, you know, of, "I don't even want to see them right now," okay, then who's wrong now? Yeah, but they... No. I'm saying if you still feel that way, who's wrong this morning? And who needs to get it right? See, this message is not a shout or outer. This message is not a... This is, here, it's not fun to preach. It's not something as a pastor that you want to, you know, lay out. It's no fun when somebody says, you mean I've got to bring this stuff up that I push back in my life. All I'm asking you to do is bring it to Jesus. Say, oh dear God, I've carried this stinking baggage too long. I'm tired of bearing this load by myself. Would you please take it? And let the Son of God, behold the Lamb of God, which what? Taketh away the sin of the world. Be good. Hey, how about walking out of here like a 1,000,000 pounds lighter? How about walking out of here with a clean conscience? How about walking out of here with a clean heart? How about walking out of here with the touch of God again? Amen. How about walking out of here with the joy of the Lord? Amen. Preacher, you think God could do that? The Bible says, casting all your care upon Him, for He careth for you. I think it can be done. Sometimes, hey, we need to ask God to forgive us. In our heart, you need to get on your knees and ask God to forgive the one that offended you. God, forgive them. Lord, help me. Forgive me for what I felt to them, but God, help them. Pray for them. If you've done wrong, do this. How about forgive yourself and get it out of the way? I'll never forgive myself for what I did. Really, there's not a whole lot in the Bible that the Bible talks about forgiving yourself. It talks about God forgiving you. Because here's what I believe. When we come to God with a repentant heart and we ask God to forgive us, then the Bible gives us verses about how we're accepted in the beloved. In other words, our placement with God. God begins to show us that and we realize, God, then if I've come to you, you have washed me, you have cleansed me. I've gone, if there's a way, if I've offended my brother, now if you're the offender, go to your brother and get it right. If you are the offender, go to your brother and get it right, like the Bible says. Good. Go to them. If you are the offender. But here, don't you, if you're the, let's say, victim, don't sit around with some chip on your shoulder saying, that's right, they ought to come ask me for forgiveness. That's right, they owe me that. Then that reveals how wrong you are. Amen. That reveals that bitter spirit in your heart. Come on. I'm not preaching this to, here, this is not one of those, I'm certainly not, you say, preacher, you just want to bring up old hatchets. Now, what I'm praying is for you to bring up old sin. Amen. Confess it, get it gone, get it right. Amen. Hey, walk out of here from here on. Hey, wouldn't it be a blessing for a husband and wife to be closer than they've ever been because a husband or a wife got right with the Lord? Amen. There's never a time. Hey, I don't know any husband or wife that on a weekly basis or maybe daily doesn't need to say, I'm sorry. Hey, your spouse deserves that. Don't be that hard-headed nut spouse that never says, I'm sorry. You know, well, the other one always apologizes. Why don't you apologize, hard head? Something's wrong with you. Get it right. But I know this. I read in Ephesians what the Bible said. He said, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace to the hearers, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be ye kind one to another, forgiving one another. By the way, here's the kicker. Even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Jesus could look at his own murderers, people that had just nailed him to the cross, people that spit on his face, that buffeted him, and Jesus said to them hanging on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Son of God looked at hit face to face with his own murderers. I want to tell you something. I don't care what they've done to you. The Lord, hey, I look at what Christ has done for me. His forgiveness for me far outweighs anything that somebody has done to me. So that's how, when I take that verse, it says, forgiving, and be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Boy, when I look at how much God's forgiven me of, then no one person has ever done as much to me, listen to this, as I've done to Christ. Nobody. Nobody has ever done to you what we personally, what Christ had to die for. So that right there is enough to say that then I got to get this out of my life. I don't want this on my heart. I don't want it in my life. I'm not going to let. By the way, the longer you stay angry and hurt, then you're letting that person control you. I didn't think you thought that highly of them, as to let them control your feelings and your emotions and your thoughts and your heart. I think I'd get it right.
Thank you for choosing to watch this sermon preached at Heritage Baptist Church. Heritage Baptist Church is located at 1843 Peeksville Road, Locust Grove, Georgia, 30248. You can contact us at 770-320-7771. Visit us on the web at www.hbcga.com.